talking about car kits and get home kits. So today, this is a topic I always enjoy. It's definitely one of my favorite topics. And actually on our the city's YouTube, there's a video snip from it's quick preparedness tips. And I actually do a little discussion. This is part of it, is car kits. So I might actually bring up a little snippet of the video to show that kind of ease of pulling a suitcase out of a car. So first off, get home kits or car kits. So really, what do you keep in your car, and can you get home or to work with it? What's going to be that best course of action for you? So being prepared wherever you are is very important. It really makes a huge difference in thinking about, are you okay where you are? You know, one of those things that people, hey, if I'm out shopping and something happens, am I going to be okay if I can't get home? And the thought process here is really, how can I make sure I can get home? How can I make sure that I am okay? And for me, in both my work vehicle and my personal vehicle, and in my wife's car, we have kits in all of them. And we find it really important. It's just one of those, part of it makes me feel really comfortable and prepared, but it's kind of my job. So do you, you know, kind of that, and we talked about this before with communication, but can you get home? For me, getting home or getting back to work is really important. So we're 2 weeks ready at home. I have a lot more preparedness stuff at home. My wife's there, my dog's there. Like, I probably want to go home first if I can, check in, and then, you know, get to work. So really, you got to think about a couple things. How far do you usually travel from home, and what are kind of the big obstacles for you? A colleague of mine, pretty much has his canoe on his roof always. Just that's where it lives. It lives on the roof of his SUV because he works on one side of the river and lives on the other side. So for him, it's really important that he can get home. So he quite literally keeps a canoe on his roof. So if you ever see a Nissan SUV with a red canoe on the roof, that's the guy I know. So how far do you travel? Do you have the shoes that you need? How long would that walk be? Is it going to be a day or two or three? What is that? So what supplies do you need? You know, what is that impact overall? You know, what is the impact? Do you need a day of supplies? Do you need a couple hours of supplies? Or do you need 3 to 5 days of supplies? Really consider where you are. And at what point is it, I'm not trying to get home, I'm trying to get to an evacuation center or trying to get to somewhere else where I can go and not be in the impacted area. So really part of that consideration, part of that planning process of what goes in your kit can really be fundamentally based on what your needs are. And I talked about this a lot in the communications presentation. I talked about it in the pets presentation. Figure out those needs, evaluate them, write a plan for it, and then build your kit to that to make sure that you are setting yourself up for success. The basics are really shoes, clothes, food, water, and medication. Personally, I have a backpack in my work truck, but in my car, and you'll see that actually in the next slide, I have a plastic tote, but in my wife's car, we actually have one of our suitcases. It's just wheels make things easier. For me, I've been in the military for 14 years. It's pretty easy for me to throw a backpack on and go 10 to 15 miles and in a day. You know, that's not hard for me. But that's not easy for everyone. And also it's Oregon, consider waterproofing or what you need. Trash bags make a huge world of difference. I actually keep in all of my bags, I generally have a heavy duty trash bag, that if I needed to create a rain fly or rain, you know, kind of poncho with bag cover, I can. Again, if I have clothes or stuff I'm trying to keep dry, I really want to make sure that I plan for that appropriately. So go to the next slide, really preparing your car. So this is actually a picture of my car, and you see on that left side right there, that black tote. And that's, I'm actually going to break that whole thing down and show you in the next slide what goes into that. But things to consider is keeping your tank at least half full. Again, when there's no power power or internet, you can't pay for things. You can't pay for gas. The pumps don't work. The credit card machine doesn't work. So keeping your tank at least half full means you can get somewhere with what you have in your car. Always just consideration. I know stopping at half a tank and filling up again is annoying, but once you get into the habit of it, it's really just becomes a normal habit. You know, oh, hey, I'm hitting half a tank. I'm going to stop and fill up. Think about water, snacks, food. I don't like being hangry, so I pretty much always have water and snacks in my car anyway. Extra medications, first aid kit, flashlight, sturdy shoes, or a change of socks. I generally wear boots anytime, boots or shoes, just about anytime I wear the house. I don't usually leave my house in flip-flops. Oh, I'm so sorry. I can't stop yawning all of a sudden. Think about road flares, reflectors or flashers. And then also, if you have a spare tire, know how to change it. That is incredibly important. So as we look at what is actually laid out in my suit, in my car kit, I'm going to turn on my little annotation here. And I'm going to start with, first off, I use a plastic tote that has no holes in it. So again, I work downtown. I live across the river. So for me, it's really important that I could actually put all my stuff in there, grab some of the duct tape that's over here, make sure it's sealed, and float across the river with it, and try to keep my stuff mostly dry. That's pretty important for me. And then I have my backpack, and this is just an old military backpack I had that has a first aid kit attached to it. So again, backpack, first aid kit, way of carrying it, way of keeping it dry, all things that are just part of that fundamental part. I have some hand warmers up here, and there's a space blanket on this side over here. So really, how do I keep warm if it's cold? You know, it's Oregon, gets cold, especially if it's late at night. And then I have some warm clothes. So I actually have warm socks, a thermal, military thermal underlayer, and then two extra t-shirts, and then an extra pair of underwear. Just got to have it. But those are things that if I'm in my work attire or what I usually leave my house in, I will be okay with just a change of socks and a t-shirt, and maybe a little thermal layer. And then I also have a little raincoat that folds up nicely that I stick in there. And I put that in a waterproof dry bag. Just have plenty of them. So I'm going to clear that just to get away that, take away some of the distractions. Now, as we continue to look at the kit, I actually have a baseball cap if it's sunny. I have a winter hat if it's cold. Toilet paper, as always. I will always tell you to have toilet paper and everything you got. Some basic toiletries. So I have some body wipes. I have some anti-chafing powder. Toothbrush, toothpaste, chapstick, just some of those basic things. There's my plastic bag. So if I had to waterproof something, I can throw it in there. For all of my go kits and car kits, I have a headlamp. I am likely going to have things in my hands, whether I'm carrying a water jug or something else. So I find it really important to have that light mounted on my head so I can still see where I'm going, but not have to hold it. Just a simple consideration. You can buy plenty of headlamps everywhere now. Sierra Trading Post has two packs, or Home Depot. Have some extra batteries for it too. Now, also in here, I have a hand crank radio. I have, let's see, right here. So this is actually a UV water purifying pen, and a little hose to it, a little tube for it. And then I actually have a collapsible bucket. So it's a small bucket, but it's basically folds up. It's plastic. So if I had to scoop water and then try to purify it, I can. I like all types of camp food, as in if it's cheap and it will has a good number of years before it expires, I will buy it. So I have, here's, I think this is Backpacker's Pantry, Wise, and Mountain House. And then I have some MREs and I have a whole bunch of snacks. I often talk about having caffeine. I find it important. I drink coffee every day. I don't want to have a caffeine headache. So I have the Starbucks Instapaks. And then I also have usually throw some high caffeinated tea in most of my kits because it doesn't take much. Over here, one thing that I do want to point out is that I actually have a paper map. Just really important. So if I'm somewhere I'm not familiar with, I can at least open that up, find major routes, and then find my way, at least in the right direction. I do also have a little itty bitty compass somewhere in here. It's just that little corner one that I could put down on something and get at least the right direction ish in where I'm going. My watch also is a GPS. It's a Garmin. So that is probably what I'll rely on more. Now, some other tools or other key things. So I do pretty much usually have a hatchet It's a small woodland hatchet. I've had it for years. I use it for all types of things, but I generally keep it in my car just for camping and for emergency preparedness. It's kind of my job. Screwdriver with a couple different bits, multi-tool, and then just a regular knife that I don't care about that is durable. So if I had to, you know, chisel away at something, I'm not going to be mad that I broke a good knife. I do have water. So I use some big plastic jugs because they're easy and durable. And I can, you know, if I end up using it, I don't feel bad about it. And then I also have two metal growlers, which this is by design that I choose growlers because they're durable. They're sturdy. I have metal ones, so I'm not worried about them shattering. But also if I go to the tap house, I can dump them out and get some beer if I want. But I make sure that I leave, because they are both metal, I leave about 10% of this empty, because water expands at 9% when it freezes. So if I leave this in the car, I'm not worried about it expanding and breaking the container. I do have a little bit of camping stuff, cooking stuff. So I have, again, collapsible bowl, a collapsible cup, a little pan, a little burner over here. So if I did have to heat or boil water or cook something, I actually have that ability with a little burner and a small camp stove. I do keep a lighter in a Ziploc bag. And then I also have a titanium spork and some dish soap here. So again, that keeping sanitary, keeping clean. If I am eating, I'm not, you know, using a dirty utensil. I have the ability to do that. And that's as simple as put a few drops in one of those Ziploc bags, shake it around with my spoon in it, and I feel like I've cleaned it and, you know, dry it off with a little towel that's up here. Now, I also have a blanket. This is just a winter or a military style blanket that I have that packs up nicely. And then again, I talked about the space blanket. And then I also have, it's the Hennessy hammock. It's a brand. It's the Hyperlite, and it has a rain fly and a bug net built into it. So it's this whole complete shelter system in a hammock. That's kind of my thought of, if I am in a disaster area, I can tie it between a tree, a car, two cars or something. I can find a way to attach a hammock better than I might be able to find level or sturdy ground. And at the bottom, this goes back into that pink duct tape with a marker for my wife and I, our backup communication plan for our breadcrumb trail of letting each other know where we're going. All right, let me clear the drawings, close this, go to the next slide. So there's actually, let me see if I can switch real quick to show this. All right, let me do this. Let me new share. Okay, I'm going to share one more thing. And this is actually a short video from me talking about preparedness stuff. And this is just an example of me with the suitcase in the back of my wife's car. I don't have the sound on right now, but so you shouldn't hear it. If you do, great. But this is basically me showing how you can quite literally tilt back with a suitcase and pull it out of a car. This is, again, the bag that we keep in my wife's car. It's just something that's easy. Grab the handle, tilt back, get it over, drop it down. And this works well for my wife because, one, she doesn't want to throw a backpack on and carry it. And then also, by having a suitcase with wheels, we can add something to the top of it, like a water container. So that's just an example of it. And you can find that video in the city's YouTube channel, our actual YouTube channel, where we're showing. It's called like Quick Tips for Preparedness or something like that. So just one of those tools that we have, that it's on the city's YouTube channel. You can go ahead and watch it. That's where this one is as well. Now, as far as the slides go that we were showing, I don't know why that zoomed in. That's weird. Sorry. So one of the things that I want to do real quick is actually, let me see if I can go to this. I will stop sharing the screen. Kathy, thank you so much for sharing that. So what I am actually going to do right now is I actually brought my work, the bag that I keep in my work truck. I brought it in for this presentation because I find it important to kind of talk through these things. So again, I have a growler that I got at, I think, Sierra Trading Post. That's this metal growler. You can hear it's not full because I leave space for it to freeze. This is just an old backpack I had. I use it for a lot of hiking, so I'm comfortable with it. the strap, it actually broke a little bit. So I had to do some strap repair on it. So it's not something I'm using every day. So I don't mind leaving it in the back of my work truck, and hopefully I'll never have to use it. In the small pocket, I have a notepad, sunglasses, a marker, just some basic things to leave notes, sunglasses, because I always like looking cool, even in emergencies. In the small pack, I actually keep an old ID that I had. So this is an old license that is expired, but it still is an ID of me. Here's some tea that I got that is specifically found one that was high caffeinated. So that way I can throw that in. A little first aid kit. So here's a trauma pack, which has gauze, quick clot, some other bandages, just super useful. Again, food, meal replacement bars are pretty great. As I say, toilet paper and some hand sanitizer stuck right in the top there, which is just, you know, kind of convenient, very useful. I got my headlamp, as I talked about, which the batteries are not in it. Have some clothes, space blanket, winter hat, and here's a little bit of soap, some deodorant, which is always could be useful. Paper map. There we go. There's the paper map. One thing I've used before is actually I found a small candle that was $1.99. And the thought here is, if I was trying to light something at night, I don't know what the smell is, but the thought here is I could keep a candle going and I don't need to, if I run out of matches or my lighter dies or something like that, I have a little candle. It just provides me one light and also provides me some good opportunities to keep a flame going. So if I ever needed to light another fire, it's really easy to light a candle and then transfer that to an actual fire. Water bottles, another baseball hat in this bag, some gloves. I always talk, you should have gloves, just super important. Some hand warmers, extra socks, a whole bunch of hand warmers. And then there's some plastic bags and some extra food in here. So again, these are all the things that I would hope to be able to use to get back to work or get home. Got a couple hours easily with that, or I could probably go a couple days if I needed to, you know, just using space blanket, finding a spot to try to insulate, put on all my extra layers and huddle up. So these are just some things that I have in this bag. I showed you what's in my personal kit, and that's generally the car that if I'm driving, you know, 35 miles to go hiking, if I'm driving a couple hours out somewhere else, that I have what I need for at least 3 days in that, in my regular car kit. Could probably do closer to 5 or 7. But that's consideration that I have. I really try to detail that plan out. And what's nice about having it in a bucket is if my wife and I are going somewhere, I can either take it out of my car and throw it in her car, or we can take that suitcase out of her car and throw it in the back of my car. And then we know that we are good to get where we need to go, or we're good to get home if we have to and we can't with our vehicle. I have seen people that get collapsible bicycles or put them up on their roof, and you always have a bike or something on your roof. Again, if roads and overpasses are damaged or destroyed or impassable, this can be a great solution. Walking takes a long time. Getting a bike can go a lot faster. You know, I've seen people use the totes, the little wagons off the back of a bicycle. That's actually something we've seen, I think, in Seaside. They do a race where they do a disaster delivery race where they actually take carts in the back of bicycles and they ride all around the community with supplies, with the thought of, hey, we're delivering supplies throughout the community using bicycles because the roads are impassable. That is just some base considerations and thoughts about car kits and, you know, food, water, medications, if you need them, have some good clothes, toilet paper, and just some different really strong considerations. If you are going to work, what do you have? Do you have stuff at work? Or are you going to a friend's house where they're prepared and you're prepared to be with them? What's your plan overall for that? One thing that Kathy actually shared with me a little bit earlier, which is just a great tip, is wherever you are, if you're driving and you break down and your phone looks like it's about to die, right? This is that nightmare scenario, or just that unfortunate scenario that it happens. Your car breaks down, you're in an accident, something else. One of the best things you can do is actually change your voicemail and leave, you know, explain that. So if somebody dials you and it goes straight to voicemail, it says, hi, you've reached Greg. I have broken down at this location. Or just, I've broken down at this location. Here's the date, time I was there. So at 7 o'clock, I was at this location. I am walking down the road towards this city, and just give some details. And that way, if somebody does call you, they actually have some details to where to look for you if they're concerned in your phone's out of service, or out of range. Because if it, even if your phone's out of service and it picks back up, it'll update your voicemail digitally. So updating voicemails on a smartphone these days are super easy. So just have that as a consideration, something you may want to do if you are ever in that unfortunate situation. So at this time, if anybody has any questions, I'm going to pop the chat back open over here. If you have questions, please ask. Otherwise, thank you very much again for joining us for a lunchtime presentation. If anybody has any thoughts, concerns, or ideas, I'm happy to hear them or talk about them. One other thing is also plan for your pets and kids or anybody else you may drive regularly. You know, I always have a leash and collar for a dog in my car. And the number of times I've pulled over both my work truck and my personal vehicle and stepped out into the street to try to catch a dog that's running around, and been glad I had a, you know, grab the leash with the collar, go over, clip it, contain it, gain positive control of that dog, and make sure it's safe. And that also takes away that that threat from other drivers or anybody else that might be injured by it. So I always plan for that. But again, planning for if my dog's with me, I usually have in my personal car, something that wasn't on there is I generally keep a can of dog food or a Ziploc bag of dog food. It's just a little bit of backup to make sure that if I'm ever with them and something goes wrong, that we can handle it. All right. Question. We saw online during fire season that we're supposed to carry a shovel and at least a gallon of water. Are there the required items for driving in Oregon? Well, I wouldn't say that a shovel and a gallon of water are required, but I plan for a gallon of water per person per day. That's the general factor. That's cooking, cleaning, washing your hands, brushing your teeth, drinking. Is about a gallon of water per person per day. And for pets over 20 pounds is also, we recommend a gallon. So I generally have, as you saw in my personal kit, I have about 4 gallons of water in my car at all times. It's just kind of a habit. I know how to ration it. I know what to like, I know some extra, you know, tips and tricks, militaryisms and stuff like that, that I can handle it. And then I also, as I said, I have that water purifier. So if it's as simple as getting water for the dog, he doesn't need the same level of clean water as I do. So the shovel is great if you need to dig a fire line around your car. Ideally, you're not in that situation. Let's see, you're in Grand Ron and work in Salem. That's where Department of Forestry, third item. Okay, so yeah, if you're out in that area, if you're doing a little bit longer of a drive, definitely, I recommend that food, water, medication factor. You know, do you have meds? Can you keep a few extras? How long would it take you to walk home? If that road isn't passable or it's closed for some reason, you know, can you bike home? Is there somewhere in town that you can, a friend or somebody else that you can stay with until things balance out a little bit more? And then can you contribute to their preparedness so they can handle you as well? The shovel factor is if you're stuck or if you need to try to dig a fire line around your vehicle. And then water, I just always recommend having water in your car for all of the many, many reasons. And then one of the things, my water bottle is actually is my phone stand right now, because I didn't have good service on my tablet. But I have a water bottle. I'm a water bottle person. And the reason for that is if I fill my water bottle before I leave anywhere, I know I have water with me. And that's just one of those things that's, an easy, your office water bottle, your regular Nalgene bottle. I fill it before I leave work, before I go to work, before I leave my house, before I go from one meeting to another in a building that's, a little bit further away from any of my additional preparedness kits. Just the thought of having that extra water is important to me. All right. Yeah. And shovels, I used to keep a folding shovel in my car, which was great in New England where it snowed and I had issues like that all the time. And the number of times I used my little folding shovel to dig myself out is great. But again, if you're Grand Ronde Salem, you're not dealing with too much snow, if that's the case. Pretty few and far between, maybe over the hill once in a while. But, you know, Oregon Department of Forestry also covers a lot of the mountain ranges where having a shovel in your car, especially if you're traveling up towards Bend or going over any of the passes, having a shovel in your car is incredibly useful and incredibly helpful for a multitude of reasons. All right. So thank you all very much for joining us again. I super appreciate it. I think our next class is actually scheduled to be next week. Kathy, can you confirm that? I know we changed this week's because I was away last week at a training, but next week should be back to the regular schedule, which will be November 3rd, and we'll be talking about shelters.